lot of teams we were smashing teams as well, weren't we, by 40 and 50 points. So, but then again, we had a good team morale. I think we had a bit, all the squad between 22 and 28, 29, which is like prime for rugby. Mm. And we were all going out together. Had a lot of team dues after having a few beers together and that. And it seemed to all quite well. Not realising it had shit in it, thinking it were his, but you know, talking over that way. Realise, flicked it away, and it went off of, like, I think it landed on Tyler Eppie and some other lad, and Benny were fuming, and then two other lads started windmilling at each other, thinking that it was Benny Cocaine on his high horse and that, and he just went, looked around like this, watched this, just went flying off a club and just launched us into a Christmas tree and just all collapsed.
Bug's life, innit?
Yeah, fucking
what do you do there? I heard some shouting behind me. I looked and there were Greg, Crooksy and Badge all stood there. So I'm like, the fuck? So then I carried on fighting for a bit and then it stopped. And then I don't know why I was a bit pissed off with Badge that he'd commented on. So I just fucking walked up to Badge and punched him as well.
Quick word from our sponsors of today's podcast, Braithwaite Mini Digger Services. For all of your landscaping needs, from concreting work to garden clearances, fencing and paving, they provide a service for any type of gardening needs. Specialists in all type of machinery works, no job too big or too small. Check them out on Facebook at Braithwaite Mini Digger Services. Back to the pod.
You do mini podcasts. I had a little bit of a study last night, see if you'd been in the...
I did one. This kid once asked me on Instagram, and it was just basically rugby-based. I think he was like from Merseyside way, and he was just asking me about like career and that, and been going to Australia and coming back, and how I found it, stuff like that. That's only one really. I've been on a talk, but I think I went on a talk radio show as well. You know, one that's opposite Leeds United.
All right.
I just went on that, did a few, it was like a quiz and stuff like that, and a bit of radio and stuff. But that's
I also watched one where you must have gone and got your car wrapped.
Oh yeah.
So that geezer sort of making you chuck ball into fucking thing and that.
Yeah, a few. Yeah, well, I went and got a Range Rover Velar, but like I'd been looking, and it looked sick with this kit on it. So I went there, did me like a bit of a deal for like a bit of a promo video and that. I'd be chucking ball through Hooper, brought me mum along, she were doing it and all. But yeah, fucking did that and. Crashed it 4 months later.
Did you? You've always liked your cars. I remember ever since I was working a lot lane, you've always had always liked your vehicles. Like, is that something you've always had a passion for?
I think if you're earning some money and you save up, I like to, you know, I'd like to have a nice car with it. But once got in trouble when I was at Huddersfield back in the day it was my first like proper contract.
Do you have a Sirocco?
Yeah, I bought a Sirocco and fucking hell, it nearly sent me out at club.
What just does this boy think he is? What's
yeah,
he?
Pretty much. Think I bought it a bit too soon and thought with the man like. So.
Are you, I've got a lot of rugby mates. Are you a bit of a rugby, not nerd, but are you into the game? Obviously, you're a professional athlete. Do you love the sport? Are you still a bit, do you watch it outside of?
I do. There's some players that are involved and they're not, because they do it that much, they're not really interested in watching games or they find it a bit boring, but. Say because I've done it from that young, I'm just interested in it. I like to see other lads that are doing well, or compare myself to people, or just I just like watching it as well. Used to be big into NRL and that, but I don't really watch that as much now.
It's a better spectacle to watch, isn't it?
It's loads better, isn't it? Commentary and everything. Mm. Just way they hype it up. But then again, there's loads more money in it, so they can afford to do it.
Do they still allow Alt Biff and that in NRL?
Nah, not really. Like,
the only reason I used to watch it.
Yeah, for a bit of scuff. Mm. Origins were best, weren't they? Yeah. Fighting and that.
Yeah.
All videos that pop up on Facebook, they're class to watch, but yeah, they don't let you get away with it anymore. It's all safety rules and stuff, innit?
What do you think to that? So an example I'll use, and I've not been watching much rugby this year, but I just watched Richie Myler with his sort of like, it was barely something of nothing.
Well, some players are playing for it now, aren't they? To try and get a penalty. It's a little...
Like football.
Yeah, it's not as much like football, but you can see what they're trying to do. Players are like, pretend or double... move themselves just to try and get a penalty out of it, but it's not way of game, is it really?
Does anyone coach that into game? Do boys speak about that, try and win penalties, or is it just something that's untalked about?
We sometimes get coached, like, that saying there's three men in a tackle and you're playing ball, you're attacking, you'll try and wriggle out of it or try and fight for a bit of something. But the people that are playing for penalties, they're probably doing it off their own back, or sometimes it might look like it and they've not actually meant it. Everything happens that fast, it's sometimes can get a bit carried away with it. But
do you have a feel for, I've been reading sort of like what Eddie Earn's been saying about Super League and rugby as a sport. Have you ever had a fear that it won't be here? Do you think it's going to be something that we'll see in 10 years' time? Will the rugby league profession still be here?
I'm not sure. That comment gets thrown about quite a lot. With conversations I have, people always say, it won't be here in 10 years. It's a dying game, or it'll be part-time. But I'm not sure. I think as long as Sky are backing it, I don't think it can go backwards, really. As long as there's good players coming through, Aussies wanting to come over, and there's a bit of Sky money there that are paying majority of wages. I mean, look at weekends.
Is that where the wages get pulled from then?
Majority, yeah. So each club will get a set amount from Sky, mm-hmm. but they have to play the games on a Thursday or a Friday or a Saturday night. Mm-hmm. I think that's why it's 8 o'clock kickoffs, because that's what time Sky want to pencil it in for. Like, I think a lot of rugby lads and people in rugby league that want to watch, they all want Sunday games, don't they? So you can have a family day out, mm-hmm. watch it, and it's something to do on a Sunday, but it's a bit of an hindrance when it's Thursday night for fans, but like for me, I don't mind it, because you get your weekends back.
Have Channel 4 done much for the sport, do you think?
It's been all right, hasn't it? I think if you watch views of it weekend, over Easter, I think there were like nearly 90,000 viewers just of it weekend all watching it. So, you know, viewers are still there, aren't they? So I can't see it dying off anytime soon.
Elephant in the room. Cass hasn't got off to the greatest start. A bit of craziness in pre-season, and then it's led to sort of the manager or coach Radford leaving. How's that affect the club?
I think obviously last year when Radford come in, we lost first five games, and then same again this year, but they've sacked him quite early. I think maybe they should have given him a few more weeks or another month or whatever, but
he didn't leave on his own accord. He's been sacked.
I think they were after wanting to know what was going on for the year after, you know, 2024.
Yeah.
I don't think he wanted. I think he said that we're going elsewhere, or he's finished at Cass. And I think then they thought, we need to plan ahead of that, and you know, sort it out earlier rather than later. So I think they wanted to.
I know you've got to stay somewhat unbiased and non-political. Who is the man for the job?
I'm not sure. Last he's come in of it last. Well, he's always been there. It's not been pretty much dissimilar to what Radders were doing. He's changed a few things, but I mean, we've had a couple of wins out of him, haven't we, against some tough teams. We've come close to Catalan, they're second in the league. Beat Leeds, beat Wakey. I think it all depends on these next
nice
couple of weeks.
Nice try as well, that mate.
Yeah, I know. Back on wing as well. I've been playing a few different positions lately.
Was this when we last game?
Thursday just gone. So.
Did you score, or you scored two?
Yeah, two.
I were at my dad's yesterday having tea, and I said that you were on podcast, and he went, oh yeah, we were sat in crowd, because my dad and my sister are big Cast fans, they go and watch it every game. And apparently my sister's disabled, and apparently my sister going, oh, get rid of Greg Eden, he's shit. And then you scored, and then this couple were sat behind and went, what did you say? My sister's like, oh God.
It's like a pantomime sometimes down there though, but isn't it?
Oh, you get it all.
I always want to know this. When you're down Walden Road, can you hear what the fans are saying?
If you're concentrating on doing something, you can hear some stuff, like, you know, when you're receiving a kickoff.
What's like some of the funniest stuff you've heard?
Eden, your hands are on backwards.
does this register and affect you, or do you just laugh inside of it?
I just sometimes chuckle to myself. I try and forget about it though, because you get all sorts, and sometimes it's a bit loud to kind of hear it, but some funny stuff gets said.
You still get, I always want to know this, you've played it, how long have you been playing the game for now?
Well, I started as a kid, I think I was about 4 or 5.
So you've played it for that long. Yeah. Do you still get up for the games as much as you did? Is it more of a profession now?
A little bit of both, really. If we've got a big game coming up or stuff like that, I like, you listen to music, mate. I'm into me like slow songs.
Like what?
Like a bit of Bryan Adams or something. Oh, right. Monkeys playing and yeah, that. And if before a game, I listen to that. But then I'll start on them kind of songs, then I'll start getting some MCs and that.
Like Bear Toms and it.
Yeah, yeah.
Walk out to Bad Boy Chiller Crew.
Yeah.
You've been playing rugby since you were 5. Is your body not fucked?
Look, I've been lucky, me, because majority of my time I've been at wing. You're not really doing as many tackles. Mm. I can get through a game doing 3 or 4 tackles, me. But my carries might be up there. So my shoulders are fine. Well, my shoulder's not fine, because I've fallen on it a few times. It crunch and clicks like bit of rotator cuff problems, but that doesn't really stop me playing. Only trouble really I've had is, because I'm quite fast twitch, I get quite a few muscle problems in my calves and hammies, because I do quite a bit of meterage as well.
Yeah, a lot of full lengthers.
Yeah, so towards back end recovery, I've got to keep up with, like, with my recovery and stuff. But other than that, like, I feel my body feels sweet.
I think we might have asked Zach, how professional is the recovery for sort of Cass put a lot of focus on it?
Not, yeah, kind of. We like book, you know, new facility up at Park where it's Baths.
Aspire.
Yeah, we'll book that out day after a game, do a few lengths and just some stretching and pull and stuff. But probably compared to some bigger clubs like Leeds and Saints and that, they've all got their hydrotherapy pools and, you know, their ice plunging baths and that. Where we're struggling, like, for facilities.
You're like jumping at River Air and that.
Yeah, straight off cold too.
Talk me through. I know you played a little bit of, I was listening to some stuff last night, you played a little bit of rugby in Australia. I think you went out to Brisbane.
Yeah.
How was that as an experience?
Oh, it was class. Like, it was something that I'd always wanted to do. It was a bit of a strange story, really. I was at Hull Castle, had 3 years left on my deal, and I got a phone call off an Aussie bloke. You know what used to happen when you were younger and someone used to ring you messing about?
Did you ever hear about when I did that?
No.
I'll tell a story after this. It's a fucking mad one.
So I got a phone call. Like, I'd gone on loan to Salford, I think, for 4 weeks. So I were out of favour. I'd been out on piss or something and got in trouble. So somebody from Australia must have been keeping tabs on me and monitoring me. And he'd seen that I'd moved clubs. And I got a random call. It were an agent. I can't remember the bloke's name. And I thought it was one of my mates pissing about saying, oh, would you want to come over and that? I didn't believe it, and then he rung me back day after, and he said,
"Were you just like, what were you like on first phone call?" Just yeah.
I was laughing a bit, and he said, and he was saying like, "Oh, I've got a club interest," so I just went along with it. I thought, I'm trying to pick in my brain, thinking who could this be winding me up. And then day after he rung back with some details and that about who wanted me and like what kind of money they'd be offering to pay. And I kind of think, oh, you know, it'll be all right that. So I followed it up with my agent at time and said, oh, this is what, can you follow it up and chase it? And it ended up being all like legit.
Mm-hmm.
So I had to ask OKR if I could have a release just because I wanted to move over there. And they weren't happy about it at first. And then they kind of said, all right, if we can find someone to replace you, we'll let you go. And they ended up finding someone. So I went. And then once I'd signed it all, they ended up changing their mind and offering me a better deal to stay. It was decent, it was better than what I'd signed in Oz, so fucking hell. But then they had my heart set in it then. I just wanted to go and see what it was like.
Who did you go and play for?
Brisbane. So first year, I didn't play at all, but they have like feeder teams over there, don't they, which were called Wynnum Manly, which is like in a Queensland competition, which is like equivalent to like top end of championship, like Fev and Batley and stuff, and then probably lower couple of Super League, which is still a good standard.
Still pay well?
Well, you still get paid off Brisbane, you see. Oh, so it's like me being contract at Cass and not getting picked, right, and then going to Fev on loan for a few weeks. That's what it was like. So that were decent. And then about 6 months in, it was Wayne Bennett what coach at the time.
What were he like? He's a bit of a... Well,
it was strange because I signed for coach before, and then coach got sacked, and then Wayne come in and didn't really have a clue who I was. So it got to about 6 months in, and I'm thinking, I'm nowhere near anything here. And then I must have had a good session or did a few good things. And he came up to me and went, what's your name, mate? Mm-hmm. I went, Greg. He went, fucking went well today. We could get some football out of you. And I went, all right, cheers. And then I just got my mind ticking, and I thought, fucking hell. I'll have to pull him for a chat here and see what he's thinking. He says, oh, you'll get an opportunity next year. You've got a 2-year deal, haven't you? I said, yeah. And then I came home for Christmas and that. I went back for... start of pre-season, and he went, I didn't expect to see you here. I thought you'd have stayed back in England. I went, fucking hell, thanks.
Yeah.
And then from then on, I think he took a bit of a shine into me. I ended up starting that year, like in World Club Challenge when we played Wigan, and then I got my debut against Parramatta. And then unluckily that year, I got a PCL injury in my knee, so I missed like half a year, but I started off pretty well. And then after that, I ended up coming home.
What was that like as an experience? Were the level of play different? Were the boys different? Did it feel any?
Yeah, first of all, it because I was young and an English kid, it was like I were a bit of an outsider going into it. They didn't really know who I was because I weren't a big name at the time or like done much, because they're a bit like Aussies are miles in front, and I were just an English kid going over, so it took a little bit for me to find my feet or get... But second year, we're pretty good, to be fair.
That's a weird dynamic then, that you sort of going out there as a bit of an unknown, and even coach don't really understand much.
Yeah, it was strange.
Does that put a lot of pressure on you to train well and to make sure you put yourself about?
I think that's what spurred me on a little bit. And in first year, I were quite behind in all like fitness and stuff. So obviously I would go into a 40 degree and they were doing miles more running than what I'd been used to. So I were at back. So I didn't look good in first year at all. I was struggling with it a bit. But then second year, kind of found my feet a bit.
Outside of rugby, what's Australia like as a living experience?
Oh, it's class. So where I were based, it were like Brisbane. So you've got an hour south, which is Gold Coast, and then an hour north, which is Sunshine Coast. Sunshine Coast, like all chilled breakfast spots and like jump into sea and stuff. And then Gold Coast were a bit more upbeat if you wanted to go out or get on piss and that. But
you find yourself going out a lot?
My first year I did, yeah, because I weren't playing much. And I think I were like 24 at the time, and all the rest of the lads that I were knocking about with, they were all like 21, 22. Because all the rest of the lads that were my age were playing every week, and I were like going over there as an outsider, and were a little bit behind, so I were knocking about with lads that were a bit younger, going out all the time.
Getting into a bit of bother?
Not really. Here and there. No scrapping around, no black eyes. But
what made you... So you came back then, what next step there? We'll sort of like try and just timeline your career a bit there.
Yeah, well, it was just a coincidence that it was Cass that come in for me to come back. And I just thought, I were enjoying over there, but there's always that mind where your family's at home and you're missing a little bit of what you used to, or you're missing like bits of Leeds or whatever's close to
missing
home.
Fibre.
Yeah, missing. You see, even down to music and stuff, you go out over there, it's totally different music. It's like all R&B when you have a fibre night. It's just totally different, isn't it? So there's just little bits like that. Like I couldn't have a nice car over there. She can't get leases and stuff. So we're just a bit different.
I'm going to tell you my story about when I pranked somebody.
Go on then, let's hear this.
It's horrible, to be fair. I'm a bully.
There's been a few of these stories going out there.
Do you know Kieran Gill? I think he actually plays professional rugby now.
Yeah, yeah.
So you know that time, I think when you're like 14, 15, when you first get interest by a professional club and you go and have like a meeting there and they show you all club. So I'd done one at Cass and Fev. So I knew what it was about. I'd never even ended up getting a scholarship, but I went down to like the day and there were about seven of us and I pranked that Kieran Giller because young Kringle gave me his number and I pranked him and I put a proper Yorkshire accent on and I'm like, hey up, is that Kieran, mate? Yeah, I'd just like to invite you down to Cass for a scholarship day. Yeah, we can and organise times, days, everything. Ben went to school the next day and then come and I seen him at night and he went, mate, Kieran's proper bought into that. Like he's been bragging around saying he's got a meeting tonight. He's fucking proper buzzing for it. He ended up going down there and one at scholarship evenings with his parents, mate. And they was like, oh, I've got a meeting with so-and-so. And he just found out it were a prank.
So he just...
found out it were a prank, proper invested in it. And then I think Kringle ended up telling him that it were me. And I can't remember what happened now, but I think his parents had something to say about it at school. But yeah,
how old were you at the time, eh?
I think I was probably 15. I was in school still, 15, 16.
Well, you know, that I've got a tale about a prank that I once did. Remember when I said that crashed that car?
Yeah.
That Velar. So I crashed into the back of this lad. He must have only been about 18. I must have been crawling in traffic and it must have been about 5-10 mile an hour. Bumped back of his car. Mine were like shattered on the grill and stuff, you know, because it were been put on extra and it was sticking out. There were hardly any marks on his car, and him and his bird jumped out of the car and they were both absolutely sound. I said, are you all right, mate? I didn't hurt you or anything. Nah. He said, oh, nah, we're all right. It's just my car. I says, oh, if we don't go through insurance, I'll pay for it for you. I think it must have been about 300 quid's worth of damage. And he says, oh, yeah, no problem. So I took his number and that. I was going to get it booked in at garage. And then I got a phone call off my insurance and he'd like put a claim in against me.
Bastard, yeah.
So I had his number. So I just like, I rung him up and pretended to be insurance company.
What do you say, premium's going to be massive or something?
I just says, oh, we've had reports that you've claiming for, because they were claiming for whiplash and that against me and they were sound. So I said, oh, we've actually had dash cam footage off a lad, which were me. And he says, oh, right. I says, well, we've seen you get out of the car absolutely fine and your girlfriend's got out absolutely fine. So you're claiming for whiplash and you look fine to me on this. And he went, I'll just put my mum on. His mum, don't bring this number again. No, ever got sent.
Well, he probably just bottled it there, didn't it?
That's happened to me twice. Twice I've crashed. Twice I've got out and been like, fine. One of them pulled into Outon car park and we're fucking looking underneath his car on his hands and knees and that. And I was like, there were no damage to the car. I said, I'll give him a number just in case you do find any damage. Because you were looking for it, couldn't find any. I got a call straight after saying, yeah, you've crashed into the back of an Audi TT. He's got whiplash. And I was like, I'll go get the CCTV footage from pub and show you. He on his hands and knees looking under his car for damage, which they want any. And they're like, there's no point even looking.
I think people go on, don't they, and see and a realize, payday. Yeah. Or see a payday. Like, yeah. I could get $3,000-$4,000 here just for sort of just saying I've got a whiplash. Because it's almost I don't want to incriminate ourselves. But I'll tell you that story when we were on M1 that time. And we put a claim in and we're fucking no wrong.
Yeah.
Or like Danny Wadsworth, Johnny Midgley. I think we're coming back from fibre, so we're in the right pickle. Like, but still fucking leaving up spinal board.
Yeah, there were one where can't remember what it was. There were a group of people from Cass, weren't there, that got organised.
On a bus.
Yeah.
it Ash Marshall and all them lot.
I forgot about that. And I think
Didn't they go to jail for that?
I think so.
Well, there was some footage and it were like, come to a nice steady halt, and I think they just shook themselves about.
Yeah,
like,
yeah, and started rolling about and shit. That's class, that.
I think they've really started to cut down on that. I think if you put false claims in now, I think there's big punishments.
I think even whiplash claims in, I think you've got a proper follow through with them now as well.
I don't know if they can like scan you or whatever. Yeah. I'm always curious of this. How old are you now?
32 now.
When do you start thinking of life outside of rugby? I know you've got a little family brewing now.
Yeah.
Does that change your mindset? Does that change your thinking of what you're doing?
Kind of, yeah. It's like spurred me on to go a bit longer, to be fair. I think after lockdown, 2020 and 2021, I was struggling with my body and that. I kept getting hamstring tears. I had a bad injury with my knee. And I think I only managed 8 games both of them years. And then that's when I was signing my new deal for 2022 and 23. And I was thinking it could be endless. Like, I'm struggling to get through sessions, recover and stuff like that. But since last year, I think I managed nearly every game barring 2. And then this year I'm pretty much on track as well, so I'm fit. My body's feeling sweet now. I feel like I've refreshed and that, so probably could go another couple of years.
How much you got on contract? What's the deal at the minute?
So it's ending my contract this year, but there's an option in club's favour, and that would just based on injuries. So if I were fit for 75% of the games, then it'd kick on again. So
how much pressure is that if you dig into that psychology? That if you know you've got to play 75% of games. Do you go into contact as hard, or are you back of your head thinking, I need to be fit here for
Yeah,
this
I don't really
money?
Think about it. I only really think about it when I'm off field, but when you start playing, it kind of goes out of window.
Mm.
But it isn't back of your mind. It were more of as I've got to be available for selection for 75% of games. So if I were carrying a knock that I could play with, I'd just play. Whereas if I'm carrying a tear or a break, then you obviously can't, can you? But
you were sort of the man about town for a while, bit of a bachelor. How do you find being in a relationship and that focus it gives you versus being a single rugby player? Is there a different dynamic? Does the going out affect the game? What?
I was single for a long period of time, nearly all a large part of my career. When looking back, this last year or so, when I have been in a relationship, it's kind of steadied me up a bit. Like I feel like more professionalised. But I didn't really think that before. I thought I had it all nailed, like food, diet. Obviously, I went out and had a drink now and again with my mates, but obviously I don't have them nights out where I'm coming in at 6 in the morning anymore. So it's steadied me up that way. And then obviously she's class as well, like helps around the house. Don't have to do everything, washing, bit of cooking and
that's
that.
That's the one.
Yeah, seems decent. So, and then a little family, aren't we, as well, like you say.
Are you buzzing for that?
Yeah, it's... little girl, I think we're 9 days away now. Wow. So I could come anytime.
Yeah, I saw on, I think it might have been on Sky, the you were a bit nervous at end of game, sort of. Could she have gone in?
Yeah, so obviously when you've got a game like that, you have to leave your phone on, because if leave your phone with one at physios, she could ring if she's gone into labour.
You're just for bounce?
Just have to bounce at half-time.
Do you have any stories? I'm going to try and dig into some stories. Played a bit of OKR. Have you got any stories about my mate, Benny Kane?
Yeah.
Come on, let's say something. He can be put on the bus now, because he was going to come over and tell all, but he was trying to get in fire service.
Right.
But unfortunately, he's been knocked back.
Right.
So fucking just from rip a story into him. Or not. Just get into him. I know he's had some funny stories with Watsy and fucking all that sort of stuff. I know.
Yeah, there's them in there. I've got a tame-ish one. So we were in Tenerife on a pre-season camp. And we were all just, we'd had like a few hard days training and we were all like in, I think it was this Irish bar on this corner. We were all just having a few, getting a bit leery and that. And somebody, I don't know who it was, like been to the toilet and scooped some shit out at our bog.
Sounds like Benny.
Could have been Benny. And placed it like, you know, the my tables where everyone just leaves a drink and that. This were an Aussie lad, this, and somebody had placed it there, and one of Aussie lads had just got his hand round cup, not realising it had shit in it, thinking it were his, but you know, talking over that way. Realised, flicked it away, and it went off of like, I think it landed on Tyler Eppy and some other lad, and near Benny. Benny were fuming, and then two other lads started windmilling at each other, thinking that they'd thrown shit. And then I think it were that same trip. It was like around Christmas time. We used to go the last week before Christmas to this Lanzarote trip. Benny came with on his high horse and that, and he just went, looked around like this, watch this, just went flying over at club and just launched us into a Christmas tree and just all collapsed.
He had a thing for that. I've known him three or four occasions just to spear tackle rugby tree. Yeah, it's like a thing in his head. When he's the epitome of, you know, when you have a few beers in you, his alter ego comes out immediately.
Yeah.
You had a bit of a scrap with him, didn't you?
Yeah. I've had a few.
Bit of a tussle.
Yeah, I've had a bit of a tussle. That were okay, out at his house, his old house in all like a bungalow. I can't remember where it was. I think it might have been Headon area. And he had all the boys around, everyone's partying and drinking. He had like an old patch of AstroTurf just in the middle of his garden. A few beers start coming. People start wrestling a little bit. And I start wrestling with Benny, and I get better of him, I get on top of him, but he sticks two of his fingers, mate. It felt like he came out of my eyes. And I said to him, when we stand up, mate, you get in it, and stood up, bang. And then we're just wrestling. And we walk up in fucking dollhouse, we've both been, it ruined party.
Yeah.
So fucking party got emptied, and there's many stories like that where I've been with him. He's just fucking, as soon as he's had a few beers, he's a different man.
Yeah.
Built into him, just, I don't know what it is. It's crazy.
Sure it's not you, though?
Probably.
I've never seen him at that point where he's like that, but... Well, I've seen him fling his son into Christmas trees and that.
Do you ever get into any fights and that, like as a team? Any boys ever fall out?
Not really. There's a few bickers in that. Jax O'Neill always used to get in a bit of a bicker on a night out.
Did
we won up lads or arguing with someone. But that's about
What's
it.
What's that, really? Just young, full of ego, just wanting to have a go?
Yeah, I think so.
Is it like a pecking order thing?
Yeah, you could say that, yeah. And Jax he sticks up for himself, doesn't he? He's got a big opinion on stuff, so he's always bickering with someone.
But is he coming back to rugby now?
I'm not sure. I think he wants to, but he's got. I think he's got quite a lot of stuff going on, hasn't he? That's like probably worth a bit of money. I'm not sure what he's doing. He's in Manchester every other day, and he's doing something like that. So
there were talks about boxing, but we don't really know too much if he's signed or doing anything.
I'm not sure. I've heard that as well. He did say that he's. It's a possibility that he could be having a three-game fight or something like that. But I think he's struggling with his injuries. He went over on his ankle running. So I think he's been trying to spar and that, and then he's gone over it on it again itself. So I'm not sure if that's going to come off. And he's not. I don't think he's too happy as well outside. I think he wants to be back in a team environment kind of thing. So, but his mind changes every day, so we'll have to see what
Does that
happens.
Create a lot of discipline then when you're around the boys all the time? It gives you some structure?
Yeah, a little bit, because, I mean, if you're by yourself, you can go off in your own way, fall off the edge of a cliff, can't you, and drinking or going out and that all the time. But if you've got a group of mates that are keeping themselves disciplined and doing things, you've always got someone to hang about with that's not doing something bad or... Just like out for a coffee or a feed or something instead of going out for a few beers.
Zach mentioned on his pod, he said 2017, I think a lot of people agree that was probably one of your better seasons as well.
Yeah.
What was that like as a season? How did the team get galvanised that year? What was special about that?
I'm not sure, really. That was my first year back when I come from Oz. I was looking forward to coming back to Cass and that kind of things. And then mid-pre-season, Zach signed as well as the late come. It just felt like we had a bit of a group forming kind of thing in training. We had a few good young mid-20s players that have all done good things, and we all had like what Cass never had before. Like like Gailey were there, Zach, me, a few good Aussies and that, and it just felt like we had a really good pre-season. And then it just, I think we only lost about two games that year, two or three games. Just felt good, I don't know. We were always on piss as well.
Is that a big part of it then? Because when you say there, dig into that, you know, when he says it feels special in training, do you know that this is something different here? We're probably going to go on and do something this season.
Yeah, well, we were saying that all pre-season, but I mean, you can say it and do it, but you never know until it happens, do you? So we were saying it and thinking it. We were thinking, oh, we're looking good here. But then it actually happened. And a lot of teams, we were smashing teams as well, weren't we, by 40 and 50 points. So, but then again, we had a good team morale. I think we had all the squad between 22 and 28, 29, which is like prime for rugby. Mm. And we were all going out together. Had a lot of team dues after having a few beers together and that. And just seemed to all go quite well.
Is there a fair bit of pressure at the minute to get back on form? What's mood in camp like with that?
Yeah, I suppose so. I think these next two games are massive for us because we've got Salford, which are, I think, they're 2 points ahead of us. I think if we'd have won last week, we'd have been joint sixth, and at the minute we're 10th. So I think there's that bulk of from 5th to 10th that are all on similar points. So if we get these next two games out of the way and win, which would be both beatable, Salford and Lee, then we could be up around 6th. So, and then that'll be massive for as coach as well. If he gets them wins, then he's going to probably get a job, and you'd like to think so.
Is any other names in the hat? I know you don't need to say too much, but...
I probably know as much as you, mate. I've just seen what I've seen on... They don't really get told much about who's in job at training or anything. It's just what you see on the internet, so...
Does the club ask you, or ask the players in any form, is this the man for the job, or do they decide that?
Unless they ask a couple of players, maybe captain or whatever, that whether they'd ask that, but they've not... not specifically asked all lads who they'd prefer.
I know you probably won't appreciate me asking this, but did it affect training and stuff when Judd did what he did?
You'd like to think probably not, but I mean, everyone were like taking piss out of him and that, and talking about it in training, and it were day before or two, it were week before season started, wasn't it? So that probably did take his mind off track a little bit, but I can't believe how he's handled it.
Just ice cold with it.
Yeah, as if like it takes a certain person, doesn't it, to knock something like that on head and concentrate on your rugby. And he played week after, and then I think club stepped in week after that and said we're going to have to just sit him down for a game after what had happened, just to let it cool off and that. And obviously we got beat by Hull first game of the year, but it's mad how he's handled it. And it's like stuff like that. It takes a few weeks and it's all blown over. You might get odd person shouting something to him now, but
take the incident out of it.
Yeah.
To bounce back with that pressure, fucking hell.
After what's happened as well, his family's.
Yeah, it's a massive.
He's still got his kids and that, hasn't he? But for anything like that to happen to anyone, news around is if you've done something wrong or something like that, you're in line like that.
People want to see people fail, so to.
Something bad happens, everybody wants to talk about it. Something good happens, just a few people do.
How do Cass react to that? Do they like step in and say, seriously, are you all right with that?
Yeah, so lads, like we've got like a welfare officer and that. If it felt like that happens, it's all confidential. You can just go see him off away from training or 24/7 is available. So if anything like that happens, you can speak to him. Even if you're not, he'll help you with like your careers after and stuff like that. If you want to do a course or... say if I wanted to be a joiner, he'd let help you push you in direction. There's people like that to help you. So,
on that topic, have you got anything planned, or have you got like a vision of where you want to be once you finish rugby league?
But I've always struggled with this part of thing. As I've been going along my career and that, I've been getting a few houses and that. So I've always got that to fall back on, but that's obviously not going to be a full main income. So it's always just going to be in background. But if I've got a few more years left in me, I'd like to build on that. You know, maybe get a couple more and then. I'd do something else alongside that, but then that's always going to top me up to kind of.
What are you buying? Are you buying commercial, just normal houses?
I've got like three bedroom terraced houses, a two bed apartment, and then two houses, like three bed houses. So
an apartment's super easy to lease out, rent out.
Pretty much. I've been. Have you heard of that Airbnb like system?
Yeah, I looked at
like holiday lets. And
Dave Mercado and Jesse were doing a little bit of that.
Yeah, so I would just rent them all at first, and it was just like a steady income. And then I took risks to try the holiday let. And my first year, it went off like decent, and I had a good year with it. And then this year is my second year, and I changed two of my other houses to them, so I had three of them going at the same time. But then when you've got three sets of houses and three sets of bills, and then it were a little bit quiet as well, like, fucking hell, I'm down a bit here, you know? Mm. So we're forking out for three houses and paying all bills myself and that. And then I think it might have been because all working had changed or coming back off back of lockdown and stuff. So I'm going to change it back to two now, and then just have, you've got a few steady income renters, and then risk two of them getting booked out, which I think is a better way. So I'm moving towards that.
So you'd obviously, they instead of paying like an X amount rent for a property, you'd just lease it at X amount per day and just try and
For instance, say that apartment that I do holiday let on, you'll pay Wi-Fi, I'll pay Wi-Fi, I'll pay TV license, I'll pay electric, I'll pay gas, and it might come to like £600 a month. But if someone books it out for a week, it's like £400 or £500. But it might be like a worker like coming up for a weekend who needs a property, but there might be three of them in it. So instead of three of them all getting an hotel room, it's cheaper for them all to put together and all have a bedroom each. So that's how it works, ideally, but I suppose.
Do you ever think about like investing like that? It's not something I need to start really considering this, me. What made you go in that direction versus investing somewhere else? Just so what some
I'm
of the
not
lads
sure, really. I think when I first started rugby, I think it might have been Kev Brown.
It's a rugby player's trademark, isn't it? That's what a lot of them do.
And I think that's all I'd heard or heard older lads talking about. So I just thought, oh, I didn't really know what I was doing. I just thought, oh, I've got a bit of money and I might get another house. And just because I'd heard that, I didn't really know means behind it. I just thought, oh, I'll get another. When I went to Australia, I'd saved a bit of money up over there, and then I come back and I were renting both of mine out, and they were both on like 6 months to a year, so I didn't have anywhere to live myself. So I ended up getting another with what I'd saved up over there, and then that were three. And then remortgaged them all, and then that were four, and just went on like that.
Is housing still as lucrative as it was with it all going up?
Well, I was thinking this myself, because I was thinking, do I carry on with it or do I sell up or what? If I sold up, I'd have quite
seems to be right at the top of the market at the minute.
Don't you pay loads of tax, though? Do you not pay 40% tax on it all?
If they're in your own name, you do. When you sell them, you'd pay tax. But if you set up a separate business, which is like £200 set up, you only get charged 18% tax then, because it's not on your name.
So you set a limited company up to do it all through?
Yeah. And then there's if the houses were in your name and you made £40,000 in equity,
capital gains,
you'd get capital gains. Whereas if it's in your company, you don't. Mm-hmm. You can just filter your money back to yourself, like at £12,000 a year.
Some dividends where you need it.
Yeah, or it's just a savings, isn't it, for when a retirement fund, basically.
Yeah, sounds like you've got the future sort of then planned out wise. So I reckon what you should really focus on then once you finish rugby league is something that's going to bring you more happiness than money.
Yeah.
Which could be coaching or S&C coaching.
I've always thought about that. Do you go into coaching? But on it, downfall about rugby is like, we're tied in for us full summer. Can't get an holiday. Mm. And there's only holiday season is October to November. And then you miss all your, like, Europe, your Ibiza, them kind of holidays you can't really do when you're playing rugby.
Have you done Ibiza before?
I've done it, yeah. I've got a story about that as well. Yeah, that was 2017. I booked an holiday last minute to Ibiza. And it were cheaper. Me and one of the lads were going to do it. If we did it together, it were going to be like £600. But if we both did it separate, like as if we were flying singly, it were only going to be like £200. So we both did that. Reason why is because there were only one seat left on the plane. Well,
what, so one of you booked in? Of one?
I booked in and he missed out. So I just went by his end.
Bug's life, innit?
Yeah, fucking
what do you do there? Do you just walk about trying to make mates on the strip? Well, or what do
luckily,
you do?
I reckon it'd be easy, but I bet he just fucking... Dance strip, just
now I am.
Allegedly.
Luckily, I knew someone that were there, so I just messaged him and said, "Oh, I was going to come with, I was going with Lam Patrick at the time," and he didn't end up coming. So I just met up with one of the lads that had played rugby before, Amari out there, and I bumped into a few others as well. Blackie were out there, so I was sorted. Like, but first night, I think I went out in my shorts and my trainers and a tee. Came home just in shorts, lost my phone, we've lost everything up first night. So we're walking back.
What had happened?
I fell asleep in apartment and I was that like hungover and tired. Lads that I were with went back out and just left me to nap for a bit. But when I woke up, I didn't have a key for the door, didn't have a phone or anything. So I just had to go out wandering. But once I'd gone out of the apartment, I couldn't get back in then because I didn't have a key. So I was just walking up and down the strip trying to find someone that I knew.
What had happened with T-shirt and phone?
I must have just left it in Ocean Beach. And I went back to Ocean Beach to ask if there had any phones.
No chance.
Handed in. There were 22 that were found that night. Not one of them were mine.
Fucking hell. So, I've got a mad story when... I think it was first or second time I went to Beaver. I won't say it, well, because he might not want me to tell the story, but I'll just tell the story anyway. We'd gone to DC 10 and we tried pills, you know, ecstasy pills. And about 30 minutes later, we were just in the smoking area there. And I thought he was taking piss. He started going like this. Why is everyone looking at me? And I'm like, nobody's looking at you. What are you on about? And he's like, no, seriously, that bouncer over there is looking at me. I'm like, bro, he's not looking at you. And then I realised then he was just freaking out because of pills. So I said, get your hands on my shoulders. We'll walk through this crowd. I'll take you back. There were a few of us. So I took him back to the hotel. It was only about 11 o'clock at night. He was fucking, by this point, mate, he was like throwing himself about, just fucking couldn't control his body, like proper freaking out. I shouldn't have left him, to be fair, but I thought, the night's still young, I'm just going to fucking lock you in room and leave you. So I locked him in room, undressed him, put him in bed, and he was just like fidgeting in bed and looking like, where are you going? I was like, I'm going to go out, I'm going to get some birds, I'll bring him back here and we'll just chill out. Then just totally forgot about him. I was out till about 4 or 5 in the morning. I went to, there's a place called Eden there, and it's open till late. So I went to walk up there and I just seen him fucking walking down past Eden with a bird on each hand, a fucking weird bandana around his head, some shorts on, nothing on his feet, blood all over him. And he just goes, he's there, Lisa's there. So they come running over to me like, oh my God, get your fucking mate. And I'm like, whoa, what the fuck's happened? There's just no skin on the bottom of his feet. He would just bust up, mate. He'd broke his nose.
Someone bashed him up.
No. I said to these girls, what's happened? They were staying in our hotel and our hotel around in Bay, like a 30-minute walk. And we walked out of his rooms and he would just fucking, he would just diving down sets of steps, like just diving down steps with nothing on his feet. So we looked after him. We took him out. We'd been trying to find you and he was just sprinting up and down the street. He'd like run like 50 yards in front. Then he'd turn around, sprint back and like talk to us. And he must have just fully lost his head on it. Don't know how he didn't die. And then... that were it, basically. He just had third-degree burns on his feet and he just spent the rest of his fucking holiday
in
bandages.
Imagine waking up the next day, that hangover, where there's just no skin on your feet, and broken nose. You're questioning life there, aren't you?
Well, I'm bad enough with a normal hangover, mate.
I can't do it anymore. I can't have a good booze. It's just it's not even the case of how rough I am the next day. It's just a delay for about a week.
Do you know what I figured could cause that? You know, because we barely drink...
Yeah, probably.
The people that drink every weekend, they never seem to be rough. They never seem to fall out of love. Yeah, they get used to it.
Yeah, but I bet
me,
they don't feel optimal all the way through the week. It's like, no, I feel good through the week. So when I feel really bad, yeah. I'm really aware of it.
Yeah. If I had 8 pints at weekend and I woke up stinking headache, spewing my ring up.
Lager and beer now, I just think it's that full of chemicals and whatever they're putting in it, it's just, that ain't good for your lager.
Yeah.
It flagged up on our intolerance test that I can't drink lager or cider.
Oh, is that what it is?
I
need one of them then. Is it them fingerprints?
Well, I think we should have done that because he added hair samples, 8 hair samples, but I don't know if how valid that is, but mine came up like dairy, bread, like certain food groups. I pulled it out and I definitely feel better.
Yeah.
So that's
yeast and alcohol and stuff.
Yeah, just beer were on there, so I just pulled that out of the diet and then I feel grand now.
I think you should do the blood though if you're going to do it.
Yeah.
Because I Googled it after someone messaged me and said, oh, them tests are not accurate, so I Googled it and it does say...
Yeah, but any comment you get, you take it as gospel.
No, but then
you?
I Googled it though.
Oh, did you?
I Googled it. So, yeah.
Tell me, bring it back to rugby because I'm a bit of a rugby nerd. Who's best boy you've ever played with? If you were to give an accolade...
What, talented?
Just out and out rugby player, who is the best if you had to pick one?
I'd probably say Rangy. He's like, I were only, I think, 20 going into when I first started at Cass, and when I were watching what he could do, I thought I were good with ball and that, and like pinging passes about, and he were doing it behind back, one-handed, just like his step, how strong he was, his speed, he had just had everything that. Yeah, just unbelievable. And then he signed at Salford, didn't he, for like massive money, which is why, but yeah, he's probably by far, even though when I went over to Australia, that no one has, that I've played with, even though they might be classed as better players than him, no one had his skill set or like ability.
He's had a bit of a troubled career though, hasn't he?
Yeah.
He's always been in and out of trouble.
Yeah.
Has he flown back to...
I think he's moved back.
He's gone back, hasn't he? Yeah.
Is that just to get out of the madness?
I'm not sure, mate. I'm not sure. I think he's back in New Zealand. And I asked him the other day how long he's back. He said he's planning on a couple of years and then might come back.
But... I already saw something about an arranged straightener. You're already getting into a bit of bother.
Although it's all over Facebook's.
Yeah, like I follow along, mate. Like,
what's that?
Well, there were already seemed to be some organised straightener, and then there were like a picture of him shaking hands at end. Yeah. He's a madman. I tried to get him on before he left, but we couldn't really get it figured out. But we did an original podcast with him and Phil Bennett, and he's obviously got a lot of depth to him. He's got a good story, and he was class at rugby. I think he just had them demons, didn't he? And sometimes they caught up with him.
Yeah, definitely.
Do you find that with a lot of... I know there's a lot of press at the minute regarding Ed Knox and all this CT and people finding, I don't know what they're doing, putting claims in against the RFL. Yeah, what do you feel to that?
If you've got serious injuries from it and you can prove that it's from rugby, then I'm not sure. It's like industrial injuries. Like if I snap my finger and it were hanging off there, you can put a claim in for industrial injuries and you might get 3% added to you. There's a thing where, I think it's any place of work, but say if you add up to like 20% and above of dodgy injured parts, then you can get like a certain amount of money for the rest of your life every month. I think there's a few lads on it at Cass that are getting like 340 quid a month for the rest of their life just because they've got like a dodgy shoulder or a dodgy knee, or they all add up to a certain percent. But yeah, like that thing with Ed thing, I think there's about 100 players, isn't there, that are all claiming against RFL for neglect or safety throughout the careers. But my opinion is if you're playing game, you know what to expect, don't you? You're not playing it for any other reason.
You've got the option to wear head guards and shit, haven't you?
Yeah, of course you have.
Bring it full circle for me, so we'll close on this. How did Cass turn it around this year? What have the boys got to do? How do you bring it good? So I'll just dig into that for me.
I think it's more a bit of a team camaraderie. I think, I don't know if you've seen, we've signed a couple of young lads from Ulkea, some young lads, and I think that's what we're missing. Like, we're all an older squad, aren't we? We're like 29 to 33-ish.
A point there, have you got a lot of players at the end of the season who are off contract as well? Does that have a bit of a weird feeling?
I think there's about 14 of us all off up for negotiation or recontracts, which is a big bulk at squad, isn't it? And if I think they need also, there's no coaching to say, yeah, we want to keep him, yeah, we don't. So it's
a bit of no man's land.
Yeah, it's no man's land at the minute, isn't it? So I think this next 6 weeks is going to be massive. Whether we get a few wins or we can pull something together, or they get a coach set in stone who can start making his... I think it'd be about planning for next year, really.
I've got one question I wanted to ask, and it's because it's played on me. Remember I told you about when I had a fight with Smiggy?
Yeah.
You came down to mine that time, didn't you? What the fuck? Why did he come to my house?
Because we were in Royal Oak, weren't we, pissed up?
Yeah.
I think, weren't you having a bicker on somebody's...
Yeah, but it wasn't out to do with Smiggy, it was to do with Holmesy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And well, then I remember Smiggy...
Were you just calling people out on Facebook?
No, not really. I set Holmesy and Becky, his ex-wife or wife, whatever, they're still now, they're separated. I set them up as a couple. I think I were only 17 or 18, but I think Holmesy, I was seeing Kirby at the time, Holmesy had been speaking to Paige, Kirby's mate. Then I saw that they were back at pub, Becky and Holmesy together. So I felt a bit like, fuck me, I've set you up. You've finished with her and moved on. Now you're back with her. So because out of respect for both of them, because I'm mates with Becky, I commented something like, fucking, like, that's a bit rich what you're doing. Like, calling him out a bit. And then Smiggy just chirped up and started putting shit on Facebook to me. And Barge did as well. So I was fucking sat at home in my boxers, like playing Xbox. I said, fucking.
Shadow boxing.
I might have had a couple of minutes warm up. No, and then I just.
I heard there were an head kick.
Yeah, the Warren Head kick.
Flying round.
Did you come down then?
I came down to watch it.
Why did you come down? Just to fucking cheer him on?
I just wanted to know what was going on. I didn't want to miss what we're going to happen.
Nah, all I remember was fucking loads of banging. I mean, when I went to my dad's bedroom's in the loft, and I just heard banging around it. I heard my dad going, go away, Smiggy, go away. And I looked out the window, he was in my garden fucking going, come on then, get down here. So I thought, fair play, he's turned up on his own, fucking wanting to straighten. I did put it on Facebook, let's go. So I come down in my boxers. My dad was like, Ellis, don't go out there, mate. I said, nah, fucking move out my way. So I was like...
What, did you go out in your boxers?
Yeah, yeah. I was in boxers, wasn't I? He was in my garden.
We need some Ring doorbell footage of this.
He was in my garden.
Times, that, wasn't
yeah.
It?
Yeah, I'm surprised you all won't film it, to be fair. I was in my garden and I was like, get out my garden, then get out my garden. And then as he like went through garden gate, we just started fighting there. I think I threw an head kick and then I just heard like I heard some shouting behind me. I looked and there were Greg, Crooksy and Badge all stood there. So I'm like, the fuck? So then I carried on fighting for a bit and then it stopped. And then I don't know why I was a bit pissed off with Badge that he'd commented on. So I just fucking walked up to Badge and punched him as well.
Poor Badge. Fucking hell. Badge just came down for a little fucking watch.
No, but
I think that's what it was. I went in pub and there were all this kicking off and I'm thinking, oh, if I stay in pub here, I'm going to be stood by myself. I might as well go down and watch.
How did you make up after then? You just...
It was a weird one because... Crooksy were there, obviously, and his dad Lee were our rugby coach at time, because he's seeing Smiggy's mum. So the worst thing is about it, me and Smiggy have like kind of had this little rivalry since little school, because I used to fight all the time. Smiggy were a big lad, so everyone's like, oh, who's fucking hardest in here, who's hardest in school and all that. And in school, to be fair, when probably years 10 and 11, whenever we used to argue with each other, we were a big lad, we'd argue and he wouldn't put it on my toes, but he'd say, let's fucking sort it after school then. And I wouldn't go, yeah, let's fucking have it then. I'd kind of leave it a bit, let it boil over. So this time I just fucking lost my head. But whenever this happens with me and Smiggy, his mum like speaks to my mum because they're friends. And I can remember his mum were ringing my mum at the time or vice versa. My mum's like, Daniel's here. And I think Smiggy's mum was like, just leave him to it, the young lads. And then when I come in and I'd like fucking blood all over me, and I'm like, sure, mum's like, what's happened? I said, oh, it's not my blood. And then my mum were like to Smiggy's mum, oh, he's got fucking Daniel's blood all over him. And I think then she lost her head a bit. So then Lee Crooks come up. And to be fair, he had quite a lot of cuts on that, didn't he, on his face. So Lee's like, oh, what have you hit him with? What have you hit him with? I'm like, nothing. Fucking ask these lot. These were all watching it.
What, shin bone? Straight it down? Like, yeah.
And then I remember I went
what
to...
What were you thinking? I was one of this.
I was just a bit shook and shocked. I didn't know that we were going to go on. I thought they were going to have a bit of an argument or whatever. And I thought they were mates. So I didn't know what was going on there. I was stuck just watching.
Probably didn't expect an head kick either. But yeah. And then after that, And then I went down to watch Lot Lane week after and he were there. But we just avoided each other, and then I think we saw each other at fucking Winter Seam about 3 years later, and then we just sorted it, and then we were sound, and that was it, really. I've asked him to come on podcast, he says he's up for it, so...
Have you seen, changing gears a bit, we'll finish on this, have you seen any of the build-up to the Holmesy and Christie fight? Are you a boxing MMA fan?
I'm into it, but I'm not really, I've not seen all build-up and stuff.
You should
stuff.
Try and get to that if you've got a day off. It's April,
where is it?
April 22nd in Leeds.
Right. BKFC so Planet massive... Ice next at football ground.
Yeah.
Be a good dude. I'll
have to get to it, yeah, if I'm off or if I've not got a game day.
I think
after all,
I'm sure you're playing, because I spoke to Watsy about it. I don't know if you're playing on the Friday.
And this is on Saturday?
It's on the Saturday.
Might be perfect then, eh?
Happy with that, boys?
Yeah, mate. Yeah. Thank you, Greg.
Thanks for having me.
Good to see you, fam.
Cheers, bro.
No, I don't believe him. But know that I've been grieving. Know that I've been holding out, hoping to receive him. I've been holding out for G, but he was nowhere to be seen when I was bleeding. Cousin with the choking and the wheezing. But still he dreaming, smoking potent in the evening. This is only for the heathens. Holding to the souls who need redeeming from the demons. Still ain't folding when it's freezing. There ain't no one to believe in. I'm on that man's side, damn right, doing it myself from a landslide. Stand by, didn't need no help from no damn guy. Man, bye, I've been making waves all my damn life. Plan my step to the letter and I stand by it. Try it, we ain't holding back if it backfires. Lax, not the ones who carry crack till they're back tired. Thought they make a meal till it transpired. I ain't like them damn liars. I'm saying I ain't like them damn liars. Trust. Told him I get like them damn.